We're glad to have Brother Johnny Oxendine with us. He's been preaching for the San Mateo, California congregation for 20 years. He's been married 32 years to the former Pamela Joan Hackworth. They have a daughter, Leslie, 28, married to Jeremy Hicks and living in San Mateo. And a son, Andrew, 23, who I believe he's graduated from Berkeley now. Is that correct? And he's considering graduate work, isn't that right? Okay. And Johnny graduated with a business degree at the University of North Carolina, and he's preached in meetings in California, Texas, Nevada, Florida, and continues to do a great work in co-directing the English lecturers over in England with Keith Sisman and helping in a lot of ways and teaching classes and helping matters continue on in that particular work. We're glad to have Johnny with us. I understand that the first stage of the border between Mexico and the United States has been built, and they started with California. So he had to climb the fence to get here. Now, those who watch Facebook know that's supposed to be a joke, we think. Anyway, we're glad to have him preach the gospel to us on this timely subject, the fatal error on the promise of Holy Spirit baptism in Matthew 3:11 and Luke 3:16. Johnny, come speak to us, please.
Okay. Well, it is true I am in the middle of a culture shock. You probably couldn't find two places more different than California and Texas. I won't go over the reasons why, but at least in California, I don't have to see Gene Hill. He's here. I really appreciate every time I have the opportunity to come to Spring, so many good brethren to see and enjoy fellowship with. It's just always a great time. And this particular lectureship, of course, addressing an issue, and I think that I was reading through the welcome, and that is something that I really encourage everyone to read. That's a very good introduction to the problems that we're certainly looking at and facing. And today, addressing the error from Matthew 3:11 and Luke 3:16. And of course, and think not to say within yourselves, we have Abraham to our father, for I say unto you that God is able of these stones to raise up children unto Abraham. And now also the axe is laid into the root of the trees. Therefore, every tree which bringeth not forth good fruit is hewn down and cast into the fire. I indeed baptize you with water into repentance, but he that cometh after me is mightier than I, whose shoes I am not worthy to bear. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire, whose fan is in his hand, and he will thoroughly purge his floor, gather his wheat into the garner, but he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire. Those verses we're going to be looking at this morning. And of course, as you know, and the reason we're here, the Holy Spirit, of course, is one of the three persons of the Godhead. Is at creation, Genesis 1:2, been involved in many ways and many junctures throughout the Old and New Testaments. Often, however, the only part of the Godhead that people feel a connection with, they believe that this, with the personal indwelling by the Holy Spirit of some sort that they can't or don't explain, in a feeling that's better, or actually something better felt than told. Now, the idea of the Holy Spirit, as again you know, is intriguing to so many people. People are fascinated with the Holy Spirit. And when we think about the error that is being perpetrated, has been perpetrated for many years and continues to be so, and as was mentioned in the prayer, even more especially now, we see it being filtered into so many of the what used to be church schools. It just captivates people in a particular way that has nothing to do with what the Bible teaches. So Holy Spirit baptism is what we want to look at this morning, not in any way that is outside of what you probably heard many, many times. I was listening this morning, Brother Hatcher, Michael Hatcher, said that he had read somewhere that you have to tell someone something seven times before they remember it. I think that's why so many preachers preach the same sermon over and over. And you say, well, I heard that last year, and there was a reason for that, probably. But the reason for this enthrallment is not always simple. It often has to do, as we said, with deep-seated emotions and rather than a knowledge and acceptance of what the Bible says. People are often unconcerned about what the Bible says on this particular issue. They want to tell you how they feel about it. And they want to tell you that the Holy Spirit is acting upon me directly. And this becomes a license for a particular type of justification. So, well, if the Bible is telling me that the Holy Spirit, that I have this Holy Spirit baptism, and we'll get into that a little bit more, then it relinquishes me from any personal responsibility because everything that I'm doing is the result of the direct action of the Holy Spirit upon me. I'm led by the Spirit. And so anything that I say, anything that I do is justified because it is the Spirit that is moving within me. And whatever the Holy Spirit does, it's not done directly, but by a particular means, and that means is through the Word, only the Word. In other words, the Holy Spirit is not a lone wolf of the Godhead. He's not a freelancer. It goes about determining his own truths. Now, I was reading somewhere, and I don't remember exactly the source of it, but I told this story in San Mateo about these two groups. One was trying to buy a church building, and the other one was trying to sell a church building. And the seller said, well, this is the price that we have on the building. And said, the Holy Spirit told us that this was the price. So, well, the Holy Spirit told us that it was about $200,000 less. And I think this is one of the problems that you certainly see in the denominational world and sometimes even in churches, that people who are moved by the Spirit, as they say, of course, come up with various doctrines and teaching. More proof of the fact that it doesn't operate in the way that they say, but only in the way that we see through the Scriptures. What he reveals is only and exactly what the Father revealed, nothing more and nothing less. And the fact of the matter is that there is no Holy Spirit baptism today. Not in the way that we are introduced to it in the Bible. There is no Holy Spirit baptism today as there was in the first century. It was not promised to anyone on Pentecost except the apostles, and not some separate baptism today either. There's only one, Ephesians 4:5. As some people in the brotherhood and certainly in denominations try to teach. Most of the problems with this subject grow out of not taking into consideration that what we read about the Holy Spirit in the Scriptures was taking place at the same time that the Word of God was in the process of being revealed. And we want to caution against making assumptions that are based on equating of one period of time, that of the first century, with another, which is our current generation. Now, the prophecy of Joel 2:28-32 is important in a lot of ways, especially with regard to this. It's a key prophecy for understanding the work of the Holy Spirit in the New Testament. And there are many in the denominational world, and as we said, some now in the church, that make little distinction between the miraculous work of the Spirit in the New Testament and the working of the Spirit through the now revealed and confirmed Word. And there is an erroneous interpretation that there has been no change in the way that the Spirit works to the extent that some seem to view it as continuing to operate in the same manner for everyone as it did for the apostles. This goes back to the title, dealing with error, the fatal error of the promise of Holy Spirit baptism. Now, the Bible is God's word and is true, then anything that teaches other than that is untrue. And with regard to salvation, it is fatal error. There can't be a little error when we're talking about salvation. If you're going to be in error with the scriptures, then your error is going to be fatal. And I think that this is a subject that as we look at it this morning, it becomes logically obvious that the conclusion is that these miracles, if there was Holy Spirit baptism today, that the same type of baptism would have to be in force. And that the things that were done in the first century would have to be done today. Now we know that on the day of Pentecost, Peter quoted from Joel's prophetic proclamation, Acts chapter 2, verse 16 and following, revealing to those present that the prophecy was beginning to unfold its fulfillment that very day, with only the apostles receiving this outpouring of the Spirit on that occasion. One question that some ask is why the apostles received the Holy Spirit in the first place. Why did that happen? Because today there are many selfish reasons that people hasten to add the Spirit's arsenal to their spiritual repertoire. We look there and we see that this is a move toward Pentecostalism. It is the idea of impressing others with their idea of a direct connection with deity. And it is to give the impression that everyone has special gifts coming their way if they follow your lead. No doubt there are many other reasons that might be presented, but the fact is that the scriptures indicate why the apostles received the Holy Spirit. The circumstances regarding this matter are clearly described in John 14 and John 16, knowing that they had become more and more concerned about the Lord's safety, John 14 and verse 1. The Lord promised his apostles that they would receive an unequaled measure of the Holy Spirit's power to guide them in teaching the gospel in an infallible way after he was no longer with them. The Holy Spirit would bring to their remembrance things that they had learned from Jesus, John 14, verse 26. He would guide them in all truth and declare unto them things to come, John 16 and verse 13. The Lord promised that they would be able to preach his gospel unconstrained by the need of personal preparation. Instead, gospel truth would be given to them as they required. Matthew 10, 19 and 20, Luke 21, verse 14. So there are neither heirs nor an heir apparent to the apostles living today. The gospel message is embodied in the divine word of the New Testament. These documents, this text, carries the same authority as the messages that were proclaimed by the Lord's original disciples. The authority that we have today in the word of God, that very same authority that the apostles had at that time through their proclamation. So we have the complete word of God. 1 Corinthians 13, verse 10, Jude 3. And there is not a need today, therefore, for replication or continuation of Holy Spirit baptism, such as received by the Lord's apostles. I want to look at some of the passages that are found in the book of Luke, chapter 24, verses 47 through 49. And there, of course, the events that take place in Luke 24 are in some ways of unparalleled, I use the term unparalleled suspense. Now, often when I go over to London, I go to the National Gallery, and I'll go and I'll look at a particular painting that represents this scene that we find in Luke 24. And in Luke 24, of course, you know the story, the two men traveling back home to Emmaus from Jerusalem. And they are in total despair as they converse between themselves concerning the recent trauma that they experienced and encountered in Jerusalem. And as they're walking along the way, and you know the story quite well, I love this particular story. But as they're walking along the way, the Lord comes upon them. He doesn't allow them to recognize him, Luke 24, verse 16. And he's listening to their conversation before asking them what series of events they were referring to that's created such gloomy and sullen anxiety. And these men are just amazed that he has no idea what they're talking about, that he's so unaware of this catastrophe whereby Jesus of Nazareth had been crucified, and now all their hopes have been dashed. And they ask, are you a stranger here? Are you new here? Do you not know what's happened over the last few days? And they give him an overview. They tell him, they explain to him what had taken place. And their reaction to those who had been at the tomb and not found the body, but a vision of angels declaring him alive, is moving, obviously upsetting. Jesus opens their hearts. How our hearts burn as he opened to us the scriptures. Teaching them the scriptures from Moses and the prophets that must be fulfilled, went in to eat with them and revealed himself and vanished from their sight. Now as a result of this, and obviously this would be an exciting time. If you were walking along the way, you can just imagine if you were in their position, and then as you were sitting to eat, all of a sudden the Lord revealed himself to you. We often read about the events in the scriptures, but we should imagine if we were there. And so in their excitement, they don't hesitate. They go back to Jerusalem to inform the apostles of what has happened. And it was while they were giving their report. If we go back to verse 33, Luke 24, verse 33, says there, it uses the phrase the 11. And the Lord appeared, causing them to be terrified and frightened. Verse 37. But it's there that he calms their fears. They finally discerned that he's not a ghost. He'd eaten some fish and some honeycomb. And then he begins his discourse. He begins to talk and provided that evidence to disprove, I think, any such idea that Holy Spirit baptism will be given to anyone other than the apostles themselves. In verses 46 through 49, then he said to them, thus it is written, thus it was necessary for the Christ to suffer, to rise from the dead the third day, the repentance and remission of sin would be preached in his name, to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem, and you are witnesses of these things. Behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you. But tarry in the city of Jerusalem until you are endued with power from on high. Now, he's talking about the apostles. And it's very obvious, the clarity of these verses cannot be denied. And what the apostles were to wait for in Jerusalem, Jesus explains further, until you be clothed from on high with power. This is not very hard to read or even understand. Being clothed with authority or power in the sense of receiving it from God. And this baptism of the Holy Spirit will dispense to the disciples power that is fully and completely adequate to perform their responsibilities, their duties, their task in Jerusalem and among the nations. And it corresponds with what Jesus had told them in John chapter 14, verses 16 and 17, and in John 16 and verse 13 with regard to the comfort. Now, we go along in this particular way because I think if we show what the Bible says, then anything other than what it says has to be untrue. And we see he will guide you in all truth. Now, when we move then from Luke 24 over to the book of Acts chapter 1, and we now see at the point which the Lord said, the things that he had said in Luke 24:49 begins to come into view. Being assembled together with them, Jesus commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, wait for the promise of the Father. And then when they therefore will come together, and again, this is the disciples. Ye shall receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses of me, both in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria and unto the othermost parts of the earth. Not only does Luke pick up where he left off in his gospel account in Luke 24, but he reemphasizes that the disciples, the 11 from Luke 24:33, are the ones receiving or being clothed with the power that was promised of the Father, Holy Spirit. And one can also see, I believe it's pretty clear and evident in the scriptures, that the promise that's being described is described as a baptism. And this theme of the Father's promise is incontrovertibly an allusion to the Holy Spirit, Luke 24, verse 49. Clothed with power from on high, a theme that Luke traces from early on in his volumes, both of Luke chapter 3, verses 13 through 17, which he develops in Acts chapter 2, and then later we see in chapter 10 and in chapter 11. In Matthew chapter 3, verses 7 through 12, it comes down to a part where it says, whose fan is in his hand, and he will purge his floor, gather his wheat into the garner, but he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire. Now, when we think about John, all were wondering at one point, John the Immerser, whether he was the Christ. And he answered them, and this is the record of what he was saying, I baptize you with water, but one mightier than I cometh. And he says, he will baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. And I look at those two, the verses that we're looking at this morning, Matthew chapter 3, Luke as well. And you look at the events that precede, that are surrounding and that follow that particular statement. And in looking at that, when we look at that, it gives us more than a hint as to what John and the Lord mean when they said he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire, regardless of the variant attempts at interpretations by those who are avoiding what is obvious and attempting to impose or insert unscriptural views. Now, Brother Denham has written extensively in the publication Contending for the Faith and Defender on these very errors that have been perpetrated, and many either disciples of Brother Deaver or his lackeys. And they have claimed, some of them have claimed, that John was speaking to the disciples, and others endeavor to squeeze out of this an additional baptism that comes after, in their interpretation, after water baptism. And there are those that contend that a baptism of or with fire, which is an altogether newfangled twist in baptism lingo, is added to the first two elements. And when we look at both Matthew and Luke, we can see, and it can be discerned, what it is that we have before us, to be baptized with the Holy Spirit. And that phrase, to baptize with the Holy Spirit, occurs in comparison with and contrast to John's baptism with water. And the rendering of this phrase, and of course you can get very technical with this, and Brother Deaver explains it much better than I ever could. But it gives us an idea in the writing of Brother of Roy Deaver at a particular time. He put it this way. And it's always interesting when you look at some of the things that Roy Deaver wrote and now the things that Mac Deaver says. Because a lot of the things that Mac Deaver says now are in opposition to what Roy Deaver wrote. Maybe that's just rebellion against the Father or something. I'm not sure. Roy Deaver wrote this. He's talking about the relationship between the nouns suggested by using or instead of and, or expressed more explicitly by saying some of you with the Holy Spirit, others with fire. And so he says, the same word you, which John uses with regard to himself and the baptizing which he is doing, he also uses with regard to the Lord and the baptizing in the Holy Spirit, which he was to do. If the pronoun you with regard to John and his baptizing meant some of you, then obviously the pronoun you relating to the Lord and those whom he would baptize in the Holy Spirit likewise means some of you. Some of those to whom John spoke upon that occasion will be baptized in water, some already had been, and some to whom John spoke will be baptized by the Lord in the Holy Spirit. This is from the Spiritual Sword, July 1972. So these, as he is describing it, are two separate categories. The phrase, he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire points ahead to the time of the church, the coming of the Holy Spirit upon the apostles at Pentecost, and the eternal judgment upon those who reject the Lord. Now, the writing of Matthew itself transitional as it is transporting the Jewish mind from the Old Covenant to the New, from the Old Testament as we look at it today to the New Testament. And that phrase in Matthew 3 and verse 11 is one that looks back both to Joel's prophecy and forward to Pentecost. And there is no denial, no one would deny that at Pentecost we have the outpouring of the Holy Spirit upon the apostles as Jesus said it would occur in Acts chapter 1, verses 4 and 5, where it says, being assembled with them, commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, you have heard of me, John baptized with water, but he shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. So it's with this in mind that we can see clearly that Matthew has Joel's prophecy as his background. It's quoted by Peter on Pentecost. When asked to explain what was happening in Acts chapter 2 and verse 12, as it forms the basis for every mention of the Holy Spirit in the Gospel. Now, John's pronouncement about the Lord and baptism in the Holy Spirit was prophetic in another way, in light of the acknowledgement of its fulfillment. Our acknowledgement must encompass the fact that the extent of Holy Spirit baptism and its fulfillment could not broaden, could not expand, or continue beyond the extent contemplated in the prophecy. So the scriptural tie-in to this would be the statement made by Peter in Acts chapter 11, verse 16. Peter, saying that God had given the Holy Spirit to Cornelius and his household, said, and I remember the word of the Lord, how he said, John indeed baptized with water, but ye shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit. So in Acts chapter 2, the purpose of the Holy Spirit baptism was to the apostles was to prove to the Jews the fact that they were now subject to the New Testament gospel. Whereas in Acts chapter 10, the Holy Spirit baptism was brought forth to prove both to the Jews and the Gentiles that the Gentiles were likewise now subject to the very same gospel. As for the latter part of the phrase, with fire. Again, going back to the writing of Roy Deaver, who I thought provided a clear and succinct answer without at this point requiring any additional comment. He writes, perhaps it is in order to comment briefly on the phrase and with fire found in Matthew 3 and verse 11. It is assumed by many that this refers to Pentecost and to the apostles' baptism in the Holy Spirit. It is thought somehow that the in fire relates to Holy Spirit baptism. But it should be remembered that there is no reference to literal fire on Pentecost. The passage, Acts 2 verse 3, says, "And there appeared unto them tongues parting asunder like as a fire." Not tongues of fire, but tongues parting asunder like as a fire. In the beginning of this article, we took the time to consider the context. In verse 10, 11, and 12, three times reference is made to fire. That's in the Matthew 3 passages. The tree that bringeth not forth good fruit, hewn down, cast into the fire. Verse 11. The chaff that will burn with unquenchable fire. Verse 12. Between verses 10 and 12, the reference to baptism in fire, it should be clear, Deaver writes, that in this context, the baptism is not something good, not something to be desired. Rather, reference is made to the final and eternal punishment. McGarvey says, it is clearly the wicked who are to be baptized in fire. The fulfillment of the prediction will be realized when they are cast into the lake of fire. Now, what has been happening recently, of course, is that one of the disciples of Brother Deaver over in the Philippines is perpetuating a lot of this error. I was talking this morning with Brother Denneman. He is aware of this. Hildrich, I believe his name is, Mike Hildrich. And he has gone online, and maybe he's listening, but he has gone online and decided to ask if anyone will be willing to debate him. You see, over in the Philippines, apparently if he can push around and bully the idea that no one will debate him, then he's right. You know, oftentimes a bully, if they don't find any takers, then the people around them will feel that the bully must be right. Well, he was called on that by Brother Sonny Leong, and when the information was put on Facebook pages, Brother Leong actually did a screenshot so that he couldn't back out of what he said. But what he did was he took the page down and he blocked Brother Leong from the page anymore and tried to pretend that none of this ever happened. Now, as has been known by you over the years, every attempt that has been made to engage in some debate on this matter has found its way in the trash can for the most part. They really don't want to debate this issue. And the reason that they don't want to debate this issue is because they don't have the Bible on their side. Now, if they had the Bible on their side, just as you would know, if you have the Bible on your side, you have no fear. And there is no reason that you can't discuss, as it says, a reason for the faith that lie within you. If you have the Bible on your side, what can man do to us? But because they know that they are teaching a false doctrine and that they are influencing people, and of course you see this in the universities, and the idea always is generally approached in a slow-rolling manner, where they say, oh, well, we can't deny the power of the Spirit. Why aren't we utilizing the Spirit? Why aren't we doing something with the tools that God has in the New Testament given us? And yet, when it comes down to a discussion with regard to what the Scriptures say, they always back away from that argument. I think as we look at this throughout the rest of the lectureship, in all of the many instances in which the brethren bring the truth of this matter, we'll see the fatal error of teaching that comes from Mac Deaver and others with regard to Holy Spirit baptism. And it's our responsibility in our congregations to inform brethren of these matters so that when they visit or when they hear or when they engage in conversations with persons who feel differently or view it differently, they'll know how to respond. So it is, and I appreciate and always appreciate the brethren for choosing topics that are pertinent, relevant, and especially in this particular case, because so many young people may be influenced by this false teaching.
Johnny must be suffering from jet lag. Gave back 7 minutes. And Dub, you don't get them. No, nobody takes it but me. We're happy to have Johnny present this good material. And I hope all of you will pick up the book. There's always more material in the book. But I have had over the years, until all of this really blew up with Mac and his doctrine on the Holy Spirit, a close relationship with the Deavers. It goes back approximately 50 years with Brother Roy Deavers, a young man, before I think I ever preached. He would come to my home congregation of the Culinary Congregation in Camden. And from then on, it just developed. As I got into preaching, I began to read much of his material and many others, of course. But then finally, as director of the Southwest School of Preaching, School of Bible Studies, we invited him to come work with us. And about a year later, Mac came to work with us too. And we spent a lot of time talking personally about the Holy Spirit. And this whole lectureship theme is fatal error regarding the Holy Spirit. And I remember, Brother, we were out at Brother Deaver's place. Well, both of them lived there in Dripping Springs. It was late one afternoon. Sun was already setting. We were standing out back of my truck, all three of us visiting. And there was a lot of hoopla going on at that time just about the personal indwelling of the Spirit. And I can say, as Paul said it, to show you exactly that I'm telling the straight of it, before God I lie not. Mac said, you know, Brother Woods is alive and still at himself, and Daddy, you're still doing well. I said, why can't we have a debate between you and Brother Woods on whether the Holy Spirit indwells representatively or personally in the Christian? I never will forget Brother David's response. I can close my eyes and see it right now, and I can hear him. He sort of took a step back, shook his head, and said, oh, no, 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 that would do the brotherhood no good. Now, fatal error means error that if you commit it, it is sinful, and it separates you from God because it causes you to leave undone what God says you must do, obligatory matters to be saved. If Brother Deaver, and I simply call on the fruit that he bore in his life, when Brother Deaver thought that there was a doctrine that was going to send people to torment if they believed and practiced it, he stood up against it. I think we've got men here who can vouch for that. Yet on this subject, he would not and said, no, we don't need a debate on that. Can you imagine him saying that when it comes to Pentecostalism, when it comes to Antiism, which he was very involved in exposing and defeating? Obviously, by implication, he did not believe that that particular matter of how the Holy Spirit indwells the Christian was an obligatory matter. He could not have taken the position that he did and that be in his mind an obligatory matter. And this is the thing that I have contended with Mac on when we still dealt with one another. And just ask him plainly why. I mean, he wanted it then on that matter. Now, he's going far beyond that now as far as his belief about the work of the Spirit with the Christian. And I would talk with him about those things. Say, why? What good is it doing the brotherhood? And I never really got a good answer. I said, why can't we just, I remember at Robertson County Lectures in Tennessee one year, we were sitting together, and I said, why can't we just settle on the fact that we have the information of God that reveals in that information what one must do to be saved and what one must do to live the Christian life? why can't we emphasize that part of it relative to the Holy Spirit's revealing of the mind of God and working through his sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God? Why can't we dwell on that? And I never will forget his comment. And I'll say it again, before God I lie not. He shook his head back and forth and said, that is too simplistic an explanation. Quote, unquote. Brethren, there's something not right when we have a viewpoint that I'm going to press this because I've been either misrepresented sometimes or I feel abused or I feel set upon. There's something wrong when we just say this becomes the thing that's most important in my life and everybody else should take it the same way, and the rest of my life I live pushing this one thing. And that's what he's done. And that's what he's doing, although I haven't heard much out of him in the last year or so. Let us realize there are those things that people can be wrong on, and in being wrong on them does not mean that they have violated what God said a man must do to be saved or what a man must do to remain faithful. Let me give one more example, and then we'll call it quits for the next session. Visiting Brother Dub here a while back, and he brought this up, and I included it in my remarks, I think, on what constitutes fatal error. In Acts chapter 6, we have the appointment of seven men to serve tables. The apostles, you'll remember, are the ones that said, here are the qualifications. You go out and take these qualifications, and you pick you the men that you want over this. And when you pick them, then we'll appoint them according to these qualifications. Well, there are brethren today who believe those are deacons, just like you read about 1 Timothy 3 and Titus 1. There are other brethren who say, no, they're not. Now, both of them can't be right. Somebody is in error. But as long as you have the right attitude and approach it correctly, it does not hinder anybody from performing everything from the heart God requires of a person to do to become a Christian and remain a faithful child of God. That is the force of this whole lectureship regarding matters on the Holy Spirit. Thus, we still have folks who say the Holy Spirit personally indwells the Christian. Others say the Holy Spirit dwells him through means. They both can't be right. But as long as we follow the New Testament as the authoritative Word of God and we ascertain the authority of our Lord presented therein to determine how to become a Christian and live the Christian life, there can be allowed those two positions. Now, I'm not saying anybody can know he's wrong and represent himself as telling the truth. That's hypocrisy, and that is fatal error. What I'm saying is that if we're going to have the unity that is prayed for by our Lord in John 17 and commanded by Paul in 1 Corinthians 1:10, we're going to have to realize that differences can exist in a certain area between members of the church, and unity continue right on. And that is the thing that I firmly believe people are so confused over that they don't know which ends up. And a lot of preachers in that boat when it comes to ascertaining Bible authority and the difference in obligatory and optional matters and matters that just don't play any part in whether I am faithful to God or not. I dealt with some of that, and in fact, I'll say it now. I presented my lessons, which I didn't give myself a slot in the lectureship, this past Sunday, and I presented it orally on what constitutes, how do you determine what is fatal and non-fatal error. It's in the book. But I hope we'll all read it and understand it. It would do a whole lot of good for all of us. I don't care who we are, to understand differences can exist in the right area. But when it comes to things I must do, it's imperative, it's obligatory, in order to be forgiven of my sins, to become a Christian, and those things pertaining to me being faithful to God, performing the obligatory matters God lays upon me in order to be faithful, there can be no deviation whatsoever. None. And if we don't have that clear in our minds, when it comes down to studying the Scriptures, right and dividing the Word of Truth, ascertaining the authority of God, and we must have authority from God behind everything we believe and practice, Colossians 3:17. But let's realize you can you must have the authority of God behind what you believe in practice. But even when you have authorized things, it doesn't necessarily mean they are obligatory. So while you must have everything you believe in practice, if it's to be by faith, and we walk by faith and not by sight, and faith comes by hearing the word of God, we must have authority from God. But all authorized things, listen, all New Testament authorized things are not always obligatory upon you. None of us want to be separated. All of us would like to be of the same mind and same judgment on everything pertaining to God, Christ, the Holy Spirit, and church, etc. But there's, as long as there's even nothing but this, different degrees of growth and development in the church from a person just baptized to a person that's been a diligent Bible student for 30 years, what does it mean to grow stronger in faith? Since faith comes by hearing the word of God, and we grow stronger in faith, does it not imply that we're to grow stronger in our understanding of the word of God? Everything, and mark this down, I'm going to quit here. Everything enjoined upon us necessary to being faithful as a Christian in the Lord's church, everything you can grow and develop in. Now you try to find one thing required of you to be faithful to God in the church that you don't or you can't grow and develop in. Are you not required to grow and develop? Well, what does it mean when I say I'm growing and developing? If it doesn't mean from this point I knew less about it to this point where I know more about it. And since faith comes by hearing the word of God, the weaker faith's down here on the lesser knowledge, and the stronger faith is up here on the greater knowledge. If not, how do you become strong in the faith? How does your faith, confidence, trust in God and godly things, how does it become stronger if it's not based upon a better knowledge of things? So obviously there's growth in that. Or you wouldn't have problems over the matter of eating meat offered to idols and things like that, as far as the first century church is concerned. He's talking about the weaker brother. What is a weaker brother? He's weaker in faith. But faith comes by hearing the word of God. Must be weaker in his knowledge of the Bible. Well, what's the older brother to do who's stronger in faith? Which means his faith comes by the word of God. He must have more knowledge and understanding. He's to bear with this one as long as that one doesn't push his position in his weakness of knowledge to the division of the church. Now, how do you ever bear with people they don't need bearing with? Ask me that. How do you do it? How do you bear with people if they're not in a condition where you have to bear with them? We're through.